I would have sat down and looked around. Self-righteously.
Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to King's Orchard. We are very happy to see everybody this morning. Thank you all for coming. A few announcements we want to talk about today. We are doing a church facility cleanup, and room dismantling with the co-op group today after church. We're going to be doing a barbecue 12:30 to feed everybody. We welcome everybody to stay and help. We have five or six different areas that we're going to be working on. Joe is going to be handling the upstairs classrooms. He will be the contact person for things that need to get rid of, things that we're going to keep. If you want to work in the upstairs area, Joe is going to be the guy you want to contact. If you're going to work downstairs, Jerry is going to handle the downstairs rooms. So if there's a question of something that needs to go or stay, Jerry's going to be your contact for that. Bruce is going to be working outside, so the grounds, facilities, things like that, things we might want to clean up. Bruce is going to be your go-to for that. If you want to help with that area, you're going to want to talk to Bruce. Randy's going to be working on the outside garage area. So if you want to work in the garage, you want to help clean up the shop, things like that, some of the backyard parking area, you're going to want to contact Randy. Rod has gone ahead and put together kind of a security check. We want to make sure that all the outlets, the switches, and some of the lighting upstairs, which ones are burned out, things like that. So if you want to walk around and just kind of do an inspection, I am going to be your contact for that. Rod has to take off today, but he's gone ahead and set that stuff up for us. So that's kind of the people in the areas that we're going to be working on. That'll go until about, until we're done. I think we have a dumpster outside that we're going to be putting things in. It's also the last opportunity. If there's something in the church that you've seen of the items that we want to get rid of, this is your chance to grab that before it goes away. We're also donating a lot of the wood tables and things like that in the room there where we have banquets and stuff to the Lighthouse Ministry. So anybody with some extra muscle wants to hang out and help us load trailers with those tables that are going to go away, that would be greatly appreciated. There's about 32 of them, I hear, that we're going to load into different trailers, so that we could use some help in there. Also wanted to touch base and make sure everybody's aware on the bulletin of the Elders Corner. It's kind of one of the ways we're trying to start communicating better with the congregation by letting you know what we're talking about, kind of the discussions through our elders meetings on Mondays. It also has a scriptural reference for the week in that Elders Corner. Kind of keeps, do you have a question?
I do about lunch.
Okay.
What are the requests for lunch?
What do you mean?
So what's provided?
Oh, we're providing hamburgers and hot dogs for people. I think it's banquet style. If you want to bring a dish, if you want to bring drinks, sides, salads, things like that, that would be greatly appreciated. We're going to try to meet back around 12:30. So if you need a chance to go home and change, we want to do something like that, you know, there's some time allowed for that. And this is one of the areas of focus that we're trying to work on as a church. You know, the co-op is a great community outreach opportunity. And it's something that they've agreed to work with us, and we've agreed to work with them. And we really hope this goes well, so the more people, the merrier. But there's also, last thing I want to touch on, is we are trying to focus our efforts as a church and hone in on things a little bit better. And two areas that we really want to focus on right now is a ministry team. So like a worship ministry team, we're looking for people to kind of help with worship, ministry, directions, things like that. If you have any ideas or you want to be part of that team, please step forward and come to us. We're also working on the finance committee. So that's one of the things we're working on now. We're trying to create a budget. We want to make that budget transparent to the church. So those are the two areas of focus right now. And we're still doing our faith, fire, and family meetings and stuff. I didn't have any...
But not tonight,
correct. We will not be doing faith and family tonight. The cleanup is going to take pretty much all that time up until then, so we won't be coming back for that. And we don't know how long it's going to last. It'll kind of last until people get burned out and we go home. I think that's the census, right? And did we get a garbage can? There is a big dumpster outside. One? Okay. So yeah, there should be, I guess when it's full, we're done. All right. I'd like to say a little prayer. Our Father in heaven, we come to you today asking that you speak through Joe. You allow us to hear his words through his message. We ask you to be with our congregation. Open our hearts. Bless us in all those things we do. We thank you for this opportunity to work with the co-op. We thank you for the blessings of this facility and all the members in this congregation. We thank you for this wonderful day. What a blessed day to be working and doing these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Let's go ahead and stand for this first set of songs, and then actually remain standing for the prayer, if you care to do so. Let's praise and worship together. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Holy, 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 all the saints adore thee, casting down their
God, and renew a right spirit.
it within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, O Lord, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of my salvation, and renew a right spirit within me. Bow with me, if you would. Our Father and our God, we come before you and we lift you up to recognize that you are all things to us. And we thank you for that, and we praise you for that. We thank you for your all-knowingness and your all-powerfulness. We thank you for your Son and sending him to earth to be our Savior. We honor you, we worship you, and we come before you with humble hearts. And through your Son's precious name we pray. Amen. Be seated, please. How beautiful the hands that serve the wine and the bread and the sons of the earth. How beautiful the feet that walked the long dusty roads and the hill to the cross. How beautiful.
In the book of Luke, I believe it's the seventh chapter, it tells about when a Pharisee invited Jesus to come to his house for dinner. At the same time, another woman who is known for a sinful lifestyle showed up with a container of perfume. She fell at Jesus' feet. She wept. She wiped her tears on his hair. She put perfume on him. And the Pharisee said to Jesus, "You're a prophet. Do you not know that this woman is a sinner? How can you do this?" And Jesus said, "I have nothing to tell you." He went on to say a parable about two men owed debts they couldn't pay. One had a large sum of money. The other owed a small amount. Both their debts were forgiven because they couldn't pay them. Jesus asked the Pharisee, "Which person did he love the most?" The Pharisee said, "Well, I suppose the man who owed the most money." Jesus told the Pharisee, "You have answered correctly." That's how Jesus sees our sins. We may have small sins, may not realize we're committing. If you read the news, you can see some of the most terrible sins taking place from now clear back to the Old Testament. But Jesus' bottom line is that all of our sins are forgiven if we accept the salvation. It doesn't matter how great our sins are or how small they are. We all need forgiveness. And that's what we're celebrating right now. Will you pray with me? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this chance, because of your Son suffering on the cross, that we have a chance to be forgiven for our sins and to enter your kingdom someday. We really thank you for the fact, Father, that it's not how terrible our sin was, that it was sin, and we can be forgiven for that. We pray these things in your Son's name. Amen. Will you pray with me for the cup? Our Heavenly Father, we ask your blessing on this cup as we drink. We'll remember the blood that was shed, the whole price that had to be paid for our sins. We know, Father, there's no other way it could have been done. And we thank you that your Son was willing to make this sacrifice. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen. Now I'm going to give a prayer for the collection. As you know, we keep the collection basket outside the door, as we've been doing. But while I'm up here, I'll give the prayer for it. Our Heavenly Father, we ask your blessing on this collection we take up. May we do so willfully. May it be managed in a way pleasing to you. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Okay, we'll sing us a couple of songs here. There's one on the screen. Should be. There. Hide me away, O Lord. Hide me away, O Lord. In the day trouble, neath the shadow of your wings, hide me away, O Lord. Give me your peace, O Lord. Give me your peace, O Lord. In the day of trouble, neath the shadow of your wings, give me your peace, O Lord. Safe in your dwelling place, safe in your dwelling place. In the day of trouble, neath the shadow of your wings, safe in your dwelling place. Hide me away, O Lord. 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 Hide me away. Lord. Okay. I've got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Down in my heart. Down in my heart. I've got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Down in my heart to stay. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart, down in my heart. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart. I've got the peace that passes understanding down in my heart. Down in my heart. Down in my heart. I've got the peace that passes understanding down in my heart. Down in my heart to stay. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart, down in my heart. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart. And if the devil doesn't like it, he can sit on attack. Sit on attack. Sit on attack. And if the devil doesn't like it, he can sit on attack. Sit on attack to stay. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart, down in my heart. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart. Okay. At this time, ages up to 12 years old can go to children's church.
The scripture today is Psalms 143, 1 through 12. Lord, hear my prayer. Listen to my cry for mercy. In your faithfulness and righteousness, come to my relief. Do not bring your servant into judgment, for no one living in is righteous before you. The enemy pursues you. He crushes me to the ground. He makes me dwell in the darkness like those long dead. So my spirit grows faint within me. My heart within me is dismayed. I remember the days of long ago. I meditate on all your works and consider what your hands have done. I spread out my hands to you. I thirst for you like a parched land. Answer me quickly, Lord. My spirit fails. Do not hide your face from me, or I will be like those who go down to the pit. Let the morning bring me word of your unfailing love, for I put my trust in you. Show me the way I should go, for to you I entrust my life. Rescue me from my enemies, Lord, for I hide myself in you. Teach me to do your will, for you are my God. May your spirit lead me on level ground. For your name's sake, Lord, preserve my life. In your righteousness, bring me out of trouble. In your unfailing love, silence my enemies. Destroy all my foes, for you are my servant.
Good morning, everyone. I feel like this is closer than normal. If I start yelling, you let me know. Yell back. One of the things I love about my upbringing, and there are many good things about my upbringing that I absolutely love and am honored by. I've said this before. I grew up going to two different kinds of churches. My father's side, and after he passed away, I would go with my grandmother to a Presbyterian church in Citrus Heights, California. And it was easily 5,000 members. It was huge. And it was awesome, especially as a kid, when you're learning about Jesus, and you're learning about the church, because the guy wore vestments, I mean straight up robes, like rainbow robes, and like different holidays you got different robes. So it was awesome as a kid. I thought this was crazy. And then I went to my mother's side, and they went to, they were a part of the Church of Christ. And I'm talking about old school Church of Christ, like Church of Christ, Church of Christ. I mean, they split from a Church of Christ to be more Church of Christ, if that makes at all any sense. And as a kid, I was made sure it made a lot of sense. And it was a completely different kind of church, all right, going between them. And the Church of Christ, man, we were education. We were, that is our foundation. We are about educating our youth. If you're having fun, that is just, we're not doing it right. We got to make it hurt. And that translated into the pews. You know, we have cushions on the back of these pews. You are lucky. I sat on those penitence chairs. Straight upright, uncomfortable, wooden back. But I loved it. I mean, I did. And then going to my grandma's church, again, it was more about the experience of Christianity. More the experience about the Spirit. And the one thing I loved, though, is growing up, you know, in Sunday school, we learned about the Old Testament. And I carry that with me through today. I love the Old Testament. I do. I love it. It was the classes I excelled at in seminary, and it's to this day, if I were to choose which books I'm going to teach your youth, it's going to be Job, the exciting book of Job. And I love it. I love the Old Testament because the imagery, the narrative, the stories, you get to see people live out their lives. All right? It is amazing. And we usually spend the Sunday mornings teaching it to our children when most of those stories are not children's stories at all. Because as I grew up and I relearned some of those stories, I realized there's a lot more murder than I learned in my preschool Sunday morning class about Moses. But it was great. We use these stories of Abraham, Moses, Jacob, Joseph, about kings and prophets and shepherds and slaves to learn what to do and what not to do. We use those stories as kind of divine morality tales. We teach them, and we look at these stories and say, see what this person did, we shouldn't do that. See how they made this mistake, we should learn from their mistakes. And we paved over the darker aspects of their character and flaws. And the flaws that we did mention, we usually mention through the lens of Jesus and through grace. And these are not bad things. I have benefited from that. Learning about these characters taught me who God is. And not just how God interacts with us, but it's almost more about how we interact with God, how God's creation interacts with him, especially after the garden. Because that to me was the best part. God was simple to understand as a child, as being an unknowable force, an unknowable God and an unknowable deity. My father passed away when I was 4. So when people spoke about this God, this reverent God that you respected and obeyed from a distance, to me, that made sense. I understood that aspect. I actually thrived on that because the real fathers that I was presented with in my life were not good examples of that. So it was easy for me, and I've seen this through the children that we have raised through the Church of Christ. They have this excellent perception of a God that you respect, that you honor, that is reverent. When you go before God, you do so knowing that you are a sinner, that you are failed as a person. And you go before God to simply say, you are God and I am not. And I'm thankful for that. And then on Sunday mornings, especially during the lesson time, that is when we go through the New Testament. And we use the stories of Jesus, Peter, John the Baptist, Andrew, Philip, Paul, Barnabas, all of them, to learn about forgiveness, to learn about grace, and a little bit about a heaven, and a lot of it about hell. We learn a lot about hell. And again, those are good things, not necessarily negative. See, we study in great detail, all right, the foolishness of Jesus' disciples. All right, we spend a lot of time discussing that and also looking at the hard hearts of the Pharisees. And those are good lessons. We learn that Jesus lives and loves and that he died for us. And more importantly, he was raised for us. That he is the mediator that brings us closer to God. That Jesus is the human connection we need to access a heavenly deity. That Jesus is our brother king that looked and talked like us. We see that during our Sunday morning lessons. And also, the Holy Spirit was there doing stuff. He is just doing stuff. When I wrote this title for this lesson, I do have to say this because it went through many different iterations. Because at first, I just thought, well, it's, we're going to be talking about how we can see the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament. Because that's what I love. I love seeing the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament. So that was a really lame title. I didn't like it. And so on Tuesday, I emailed Tanya. I said, how about this one? A holy side character. Because that is how we've kind of grown up. At least I have grown up seeing what the Holy Spirit is, especially through the Old Testament. When you read through the Old Testament, you see prophets and kings and shepherds and people doing amazing things through the power of the Holy Spirit. But we're focused on the main character, right? We're focusing on Elijah and Elisha, on Moses and Joshua. And we see, all right, they're about to do something amazing, and it'll say the Holy Spirit came on them in power, and then they did that amazing thing. Like Samson is one of those. Samson is an incredible story of someone being used by the Holy Spirit while also not being a good guy. Samson was not a good guy. But we see the Holy Spirit using him for God's end. So I thought maybe the holy side character would be a good title. That would define what we're talking about. And then when I was finishing this lesson on Friday, I said, you know what? There's an even better title. I said, the old, the new, and the holy. And I thought that would be even better. Tanya said she could change it, but I said, no, I'm going to stick to this. Or else I'm going to go off on tangents all Sunday. And no one wants that. Unfortunately, though, when we look at the Old Testament, and if we were honest, for most of the New Testament as well, we treat the Holy Spirit like a side character. Jesus is the main character. And that is who we should focus on. God is heaven. God had the Old Testament to describe to us who he is, and a little bit about the Holy Spirit. Then we had the New Testament, and that's we use that to describe who Jesus is, and a little bit about the Holy Spirit. We know that Jesus promised him. We know the gifts of the Holy Spirit. We know that when we're baptized, we receive the Holy Spirit. We know all of these things, but there's a disconnect because, again, we have these visceral reactions to God the Father, to Jesus our brother King, but what kind of reaction do we have with the Holy Spirit? When you think of it, what comes to mind? Some vague force? Some pulling of the heart? When you drive by someone who is homeless, or when you encounter someone who is struggling and in need, and you feel that pull on your heart, is that the Holy Spirit? When you read through your Bible and you're reading something that you've read the book 100 times, but you're noticing something for the very first time, is that the Holy Spirit? What is your connection to it? And so today, this morning, I'm going to try, but I want to be narrowly focused on one aspect of the Holy Spirit that we see within the Old Testament. Because the Holy Spirit is as active in our lives as he was in their lives. That regardless of testament, the Holy Spirit is active. It is a living force, and it is the will of God. It is a creating force. And at first I thought, man, it'd just be really easy to look through all of the verses and say, see, this is the Spirit here. See, this is the Spirit here. See, this is the Spirit here. But you can read that on your own. You can see when God creates the universe, that the Spirit, that the Son, that everybody, everything that is God is there at the beginning. We see the Spirit, especially through the prophets, as I said before, as the Spirit comes mightily on prophets, and they do wonders through the power of the Holy Spirit. That's easy to understand because I imagine that as a prophet, that'd be a really great thing to experience, right? Have you read through those stories and thought, what would that be like, right? To be Elijah and Elisha, to be Ezekiel, to see and witness 450 prophets cutting themselves, trying to bring their God down to earth. And then you show up and you say, God, do your thing. And a fireball comes from heaven. And I'm thinking, man, I was just thinking you were going to like light it spontaneously on fire. I didn't know you'd bring a fireball from the sky. To witness that, to feel it. Have you ever wondered what it'd be like to step before a king, an unrighteous, evil king, and to step into a court full of lackeys and sycophants, people who are there just to be yes men and yes women, and to stand before a king with the Holy Spirit and call them to their sin. Wouldn't that be awesome? I'd be sweating, though. I'd be sweating profusely. sweating. I'd just be just a ball of sweat and anxiety. But that would be an amazing thing to feel, that Holy Spirit rushing into your life. See, the Holy Spirit is as active then as it is active now. These are not just stories to show you what they got and then what we were denied. No. These stories are for us to see and witness that the Holy Spirit is a powerful force to be recognized. And one of the most obvious connections between the Old Testament and the New, especially in context of the Holy Spirit, it's about circumcision. It is the ritual. It is the act of circumcision. And at first, I thought I was going to tell you what circumcision is, but I thought that'd make for a really awkward Sunday. So I'm going to say this. If you don't know what it is, talk to your parents. I think that would be a safe middle ground. And that's going to make for an interesting conversation between you and your children. I remember the first time when Allie and I had our first boy, when we had Thomas, and we just talked to a doctor about it. And we just had a lot of questions. And because I thought you'd have to go into like a surgical place. I thought that they'd have to call in the head of surgery to do this if you're choosing to do this for your son. And it was amazing how nervous I was, how I was sweating thinking about this, and it wasn't even happening to me. And they even brought out a board. They brought out a board which they strapped the kid to, and they show that to parents. And I almost fainted. Just seeing that. All right, just seeing what the kid was going to go through. That's my experience. In reality, circumcision has been part of human culture for generations, well before Abraham, well before God came to Abraham and required him to do it. We're about to read that. That circumcision had been around for thousands and thousands of years. It is a part of East African tribes. They would actually use circumcision as a rite of passage from boyhood to manhood. That this would happen usually in their late teens to early 20s. It was a signal, a sign that not only were you a man, but you were able to date, you were able to marry and have kids. All right? If you were a great warrior, you would be circumcised. So this is nothing new by the time we get to Abraham, which I always thought it was. I always thought that God invented circumcision as some weird way to punish us and just gave it to Abraham. But that's not the case. Circumcision had been around. The Egyptians were practicing circumcision long before the Jews got to Egypt. It was just a part of the culture. But I want to explain to you what it was, what circumcision was intended to be at the very beginning, because it is important for us now to at least have a somewhat basic understanding of this rite, of this ritual, of why God gave it to Abraham, and really what it was supposed to mean to us now. Because if you've read through the New Testament, if you've read through the epistles, it pops up quite a bit, all right? It pops up a lot, especially when Jews were starting to be converted to Christianity, and as those new Jewish Christians started accepting Gentile converts, there caused friction there. So at the very beginning, we find it in Genesis chapter 17. But first, we have to recognize that in Genesis chapter 12, God first comes to Abraham, and he makes a promise to Abraham. And he says, Abraham, I'm your God, and I'm going to bless you, and you are going to be a blessing to everybody. All right, who you bless, I will bless. Who you curse, I will curse. And that would be an amazing beginning relationship between us and God. Can you imagine being Abraham and God speaking to you saying, hey, who you curse, I'll curse. And who you bless, I'm going to bless. All right, and I'm going to make you a blessing. And through you, a blessing will bless the whole world. And that's the beginning of the relationship between God and Abraham. And he calls him out of his land. And Abraham goes and he travels. The next time we see this promise coming up, it's in Genesis chapter 15. And that's when things change. At first, it started out as a promise. In Genesis chapter 15, it evolves into something more. It evolves into this word covenant. Now, covenant is huge. I'm trying to teach our high schools, our youth about what that is. Covenant is enormous. It's not just a promise. It's something bigger. And so God comes to Abraham and he reaffirms this promise. And he says, not only is this promise going to be just that you're going to be a blessing, but also there's going to be land involved. I'm going to give you land, this land that you've been traveling through. That's all going to be yours. Look up in the stars. Look up in the sky. Can you count those stars? Your offspring are going to be more numerous than those stars. That's how great of a blessing you're going to be. A nation is going to come from you. And this isn't just a simple promise. I'm going to make this a covenant. And he requires Abraham to gather some animals, cut them in half, lay them on either side of a path. And then God walks through that bloody carnage path as a sign to Abraham that this is going to happen. And if it doesn't, may what happened to these animals happen to me. And this is God making this promise. So to Abraham, he realizes this is actually going to happen. This is going to happen. So by the time we get to Genesis chapter 17, Abraham already has a promise and he already has a covenant. So what else could God require of Abraham? What else could God give to Abraham? And so let's enter into this chapter with that mindset of Genesis chapter 17. We're starting verse 1. When Abram was 99 years old, let that sink in just a little bit. 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am God Almighty. Walk before me faithfully and be blameless. Then I will make my covenant between you and you and will greatly increase your numbers. Abram fell face down. And God said to him, as for me, this is my covenant with you. You will be the father of many nations. No longer will you be called Abram. Your name will be Abraham. For I have made you a father of many nations. I will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you for the generations to come, to be your God and the God of your descendants after you. The whole land of Canaan, where you now reside as a foreigner, I will give you as an everlasting possession to you and your descendants after you, and I will be their God. As for you, you must keep my covenant, and you and your descendants after you for the generations to come. This is my covenant with you and your descendants after you, the covenant you are to keep. Every male among you shall be circumcised. You are to undergo circumcision, and it will be the sign of the covenant between me and between you. And so God gives Abraham, again, evolves the relationship, and now is requiring something from Abraham. But it's really important for me that you understand something. First it was promise, then it was covenant, and then it was circumcision. Those are three distinct interactions between God and between Abraham. It's really easy to bundle all of those together. And we're going to find out why that's a problem later on. But I want to ask you something. What about your life right now? What about your current life, all right, is a clear indicator of your chosen status as a Christian, as a follower of Jesus? What about your life right now shows others of your chosen status? Because think about what circumcision is. Think about what God is really telling Abraham. This is a sign that you are chosen. This is a sign that I have a plan for you. This is going to be a sign, something you're going to notice for the rest of your life, and anybody your men marry are going to notice. They're going to notice that you are a chosen people. So what about your life right now? Can others see as a clear sign that you are chosen, that you are God's, and that he is yours? What about it? Is it Sunday morning? Is it going to church? And I don't like that sentence, going to church, because we are the church. But is it about participating in the fellowship of Sunday morning? Is it small groups? How about praying before every meal? Is that a clear indicator for others so they'll know I belong to God? What about your life shows others that you belong to God? Without a doubt. Is it daily devotionals? And these are good things. These are great things. Is it your acts of service towards others? Is it every time you go to a restaurant and the waiter asks, Can I do anything else for you? And you say, no, but I can do something for you. Can I pray for you? Is there anything I can pray about? Is it those things? Is it maybe like a business card that says Jesus loves you and you leave it on the tables? What about your life? Do others see and know they belong to God? Because that's what I want us to think about, especially in their view of what circumcision is to Abraham and to their kids. We have to take from that, our ownership, our chosen status for God should mean something to other people, and it should mean something for us. Because it is easy to think, man, this one thing is it, and that's all. Circumcision was painful, painful, and it was a sign of their chosen status. See, circumcision was given to Abraham so that he and others would know that God has chosen them and separated them from everyone else, and they are to be different than all other nations. That God had a unique, eternal, and heavenly purpose for them. That this heavenly and eternal purpose was to be lived out and enjoyed while on earth. Yet it was always to point to a relationship and a reward that we will experience after this life is over. Now, that's a really complicated way of saying though a perfect relationship with God is not possible now, that the token we have through circumcision and later on through the New Testament, the circumcision of our heart, that it is a token of what we are going to have and that we get to experience the benefits of that now. And what I'm really saying is, as unperfect as church can be, as unperfect as the rituals and the devotions and the prayers, as imperfect as those can be, and what I'm talking about is, have you ever prayed with teenagers before? Right? I'd rather have a bunch of toddlers pray. Teenagers, they talk a new slang, they can be annoying, but you listen to them praying, and you listen to their hearts as they pray, and you participate in that prayer. And as imperfect as it be, it is a glimpse of something better. It is a glimpse of a youth telling God and giving God their heart. And that is a glimpse of heaven. As imperfect as church can be, it is a glimpse of what heaven is. That we get to come together, that we get to have eternal fellowship, not with just each other, but with God. That we can go before God, and as imperfect as our prayers can be, that it is a glimpse of a heaven, of an experience that we will have where we can go before God and we can just give our hearts to Him. We can just give up everything. But as all things, especially as God gives to man, it became something else. Circumcision began to take on a different light. Now remember, it first began as a promise, then it became as a covenant, and then God gave circumcision to Abraham. But after 1,500 years, something happened. Something changed with this gift, with this symbol, this token that God gave to Abraham. As the Hellenistic and Greek cultures began to spread, and who doesn't love coming to Sunday morning for a history lesson? But as Greek culture spread, circumcision diminished, all right? Because Greeks did not like the idea of anybody mutilating the perfect male form. So they discouraged it, and they thought that was just something weird. That was not something any real progressive culture did. And so especially in East Africa and as well as other tribes, circumcision was forgotten. It was actually seen as kind of taboo. And really the only culture, the only nation that continued to do it was Israel. Israel kept that up. And so if you can imagine through history, circumcision started to become a badge of honor because you were unique. You were different than everybody else. If you look at world history and how Israel was treated during all of the conquering nations that swept over Israel every 1,000 years, the Jews, for the most part, stayed true to who they were culturally. And circumcision was one of those things. And it became a badge of honor. It became something to say, I am circumcised, you are not. And that was synonymous with saying, I am going to heaven, I am perfect, and you are not. And my circumcision is proof of that. And they began to combine a bunch of things that were never meant to be combined. They combined the promise, they combined the covenant, and then they combined the law of Moses all together under circumcision. And really what it turned into was, I am circumcised, therefore I adhere perfectly to the law of Moses, and only we who are circumcised have the right to judge everybody else. And that's really what it became. We see as Jesus is healing a man on the Sabbath, and the Pharisees are having issue with this. And so Jesus responds to the Pharisees and says, You can circumcise somebody on the Sabbath, but I can't heal somebody? Look inward and not just outward. Even Jesus is having conflict with their views of circumcision. Later on in the book of Acts, we see that the Council of Jerusalem is convened. This is the new church is convened for this exact topic because the new church is having a problem. See, as more and more Jews are coming to Christ, they're wanting to hold on to circumcision because that's their badge of honor, all right? That's their habit. That is what defines them as the chosen from God. And so they're starting to expect Christians to be circumcised in order to be saved. And so Paul is called, Peter, everybody's called in together. And they're responding with, wait a minute, no. We've seen Gentiles receive the Holy Spirit that weren't circumcised. So we see that something is changing. Something is happening. And this is really it. I want to read this to you. This is a quote from C.S. Lewis. It comes from his book, The Four Loves. And it is a quote that I hold dear. It's just amazing. C.S. Lewis says this, we may give our human loves the unconditional allegiance which we owe only to God. They become gods, then they become demons. Then they will destroy us and also destroy themselves. For natural loves that are allowed to become gods do not remain loves. They are still called so, can be, but can become, in fact, complicated forms of hatred. What he is saying here is that every good thing that we can receive from God, there is a threshold that once passed, it becomes a curse. There is something that there are things that we can receive from each other. And then we can dedicate our lives to those things. And then once we reach a certain threshold, it starts becoming toxic. And we've always seen this, at least in this form of putting things on pedestals, which only God should belong to. And we do this all throughout our lives. We can take God off the pedestal. We can put our spouse on the pedestal. We can put our kids on this pedestal. We can put literally anything on that pedestal, our homes, our jobs. We can put ideas about ourselves on that pedestal. And how this connects with circumcision is they had replaced God with circumcision. They had replaced God with the law of Moses. They had replaced God with the promise and the covenant. And they began to worship those things and forgot what God is. And what this can mean to us is we can place church on that pedestal. And we can forget about God and start worshiping church. What church should be. What we think church should be. And when we do that, what C.S. Lewis is talking about is those things soon become demons. Those things soon become curses. And not only will it destroy us, it will destroy itself. We can place things on pedestals that should never belong there. And God should always be on that pedestal. But if you've noticed, I've yet to talk about the Holy Spirit, especially in context with circumcision, especially in context with what it became. Because what it was a cutting of the flesh to symbolize that God has chosen you. So finally we get to Romans chapter 2, starting in verse 25. And I just want to read this to you. And I hate taking chapters like this that are so heavy out of or passages out of the chapter, because the entire chapter, the entire beginning of Romans, the first four or five chapters of Romans, it is Paul talking to this church that has a lot of Jews and they have a lot of Gentiles. So there's a lot of conflict with each other. It is a very imperfect church. And so Paul is addressing the Jews and he's telling them, you guys do not have it right. You've never had it right. Just because you had the law of Moses, just because you had circumcision, just because you had these things, did not mean you are perfect. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's Romans 3:23. He is trying to level the playing field between Jews and Gentiles. And later on in the book of Romans, we see Paul addressing the Gentiles by saying, the grafted tree, right? He says, listen, you think that you're on this tree. God has grafted you in, but don't think you're anything special. God could just as easily cut you off and replace you with another limb. So he's leveling the playing field between the Jews and the Gentiles. And in this, we have in Romans chapter 2, starting in verse 25, this section. Circumcision has value if you observe the law. But if you break the law, you have become as though you have not been circumcised. So then, if those who are not circumcised keep the law's requirements, will they not be regarded as though they were circumcised? The one who is not circumcised physically and yet obeys the law will condemn you, who, even though you have the written code and circumcision, are lawbreakers. A person who is not a Jew, who's one only outwardly, nor is circumcision merely outward and physical. No, a person is a Jew who is one inwardly, and circumcision is circumcision of the heart, by the Spirit, not by the written code. Such a person's praise is not from other people, but from God. So what Paul's doing is he's presenting them a dilemma. He's presenting them a problem with circumcision, with the law. Remember when I said these are separate things. The promise, covenant, and circumcision were given to Abraham. Then 400 years later, then the law came. But they had a problem of smashing them all together. And we do the same thing. We smash baptism, church, a lot of these different things, and we smash them all together. And then we take this bundle of beliefs and lists of things that we have to believe or else we might go to hell, and we put that on the pedestal where it doesn't belong. And no, he's talking to them about what circumcision truly is. It is of the heart by the Spirit. And I love this. I'm going to end with this. It's in Colossians chapter 2. And this I want, if you have your Bibles, turn over to Colossians chapter 2, and this will be it for you. It's chapter 2, verse 6. Because again, he's trying to reaffirm what the Holy Spirit does through circumcision, what he did then and what he's doing now to us. And it begins with this. So then, Just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught and overflowing with thankfulness. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the elemental spiritual forces of this world rather than on Christ. For in Christ, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form. And in Christ, you have been brought together. I'm sorry, you've been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and authority. In him, you were also circumcised with a circumcision not performed by human hands. Your whole self, ruled by the flesh, was put off when you were circumcised by Christ, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through your faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead. You know, this reality that we have now, of that when we immerse ourselves, when we are baptized into Christ, and we receive that Holy Spirit, the work of the Holy Spirit is to remove, it is to cut that fleshy part of us, that sinful part of us, away. And we see that. We know what he is doing in our lives, and we should know that it should be as impactful to us now as it was to them then. When Abraham received circumcision, when he received that at 99, when all of the men received that, when you live in a culture that received that, you know that God is cutting away just more than the flesh, that he's cutting the sin from our lives. And that is what the Holy Spirit is doing to us. See, Jesus freed all of us from the physical ritual of circumcision so that we can choose how we express the Holy Spirit's work in our lives. We get to choose that. We are freed from just one demonstrating way of the Holy Spirit working in our lives. And we can show others however we want how the Holy Spirit is cutting sin out of our lives. We get to choose how others will see how sin has been cut free from our hearts and that we live freely as God's chosen and elected people. So my challenge for you this week is to look at your lives, to see, can you see the Holy Spirit cutting sin out of your life, cutting those fleshy, cutting the part of you that is not Jesus out? And can others see that? Because we should show others the life that we live that is free from sin, that we are chosen by God through the works of the Holy Spirit. If you have any needs this morning, please come forward as we stand and as we praise God.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for such a one as I? At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that I have done? He groaned upon the tree. Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Well might the sun in darkness hide, and shut his glories in, when Christ the mighty maker died for man the creature's sin. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, now I am happy all the day. But drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away. 'Tis cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Yes, Joe, I'd like to thank you for that very inspirational and rousing lesson today. Let us bow in prayer. Most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we are so blessed to be here this morning as a family of believers who worship with song and prayer, and we're so thankful for that. And this afternoon we have an opportunity to have a meal together, to work together in fellowship with the homeschool family. And we pray that you will use that for us, for your glory, that they will see who we are and we will see who they are. And Lord, we pray that as we go throughout the week, that we will be in the Word, in the community, and the light that we show will be attractive to people. We thank you for all these blessings. In Jesus' name, amen.
One day I'm going to say,